Hello everyone, I am Swapnil Paul and I secured an All India rank of 64 in UPSC Civil Service Exam 2017. First of all, I'd like to thank JS Corps to give me that opportunity to speak before you about my tryst with this exam of UPSC. First of all, I belong to Dimapur, Nagaland. I did my BTech in Electrical Engineering from NIT Silchar in 2012. During my college days, I never gave a thought of what's next. I just wanted to get a good job from the college, in which I succeeded when I got placed in Alstom, a French MNC in the power sector. I joined the company in 2012 July, and the first 6 months also went without any thought as such. Then after 6 months, I started to think, what's next? There were various options before me. I thought of CAT, then engineering services. But I was fortunate enough to meet a bunch of people who were preparing dedicatedly for this exam. So one day out of curiosity, I went to one of them and asked, what exactly do you study day in and day out? So that colleague of mine handed over to me the Lakshmikant book. So when I was flipping through the pages that day itself, I got a feeling that there are so many things on world that I don't know. So that night itself, I went and googled about the course curriculum of UPSC. The thing that I noticed is that I'll be able to know a lot of things, and that fascinated me a lot. The next thing what I did was googled what are the responsibilities of the people once he or she gets selected in the civil services. And in that I found out that through these services, one can make a very great impact on the lives of the people and can touch million lives. So these two things, first of all, the avenue to grow intellectually within oneself, and secondly, the avenue to serve the people, finally motivated me after 6 months of deliberated thoughts to leave my corporate job and start preparing full-fledged for this exam in October 2013. In October 2013, I got myself shifted from Vadodara in Gujarat, where I used to work, to Delhi, and took up a full-fledged coaching institute for general studies. So my first day in coaching itself, I got a lot of demotivation. I found a lot of people who are better both in terms of knowledge as well as academic antecedents than me, and I always knew that I'll have to be in top 500 or 600 to make it into the merit list. So the first 2 months always used to go with the thought that whether I should continue with this exam or I should go back to the corporate world, because if I spend 2 or 3 years over here, then I won't be fit enough for getting a good job in the corporate too. But looking back, I also thought that it was my own decision and I had given my resignation. So if I run away from here in the very inception, then it would be a kind of escapism. It would show an escapist tendency in me, and maybe in due course of time I would regret this decision. So with an open mind, I started preparing. But after 4 months of preparation, I was pretty sure that I won't appear in the 2014 attempt. But to a very good fortune, in March 2014, there was a change in the exam policy in which the number of attempts were exceeded by 2. So for general category, it increased from 4 to 6 attempts. So in that time, I took a stern decision that no, I'll be giving this year, because I had a game plan of maximum 2 or 3 years for this UPSC. So since the number of attempts have been increased to 6, so there is no point saving attempts. So now I decided that I'll be appearing for the exam in 2014. So now it was March, it was the month of March, and it was the time when the prelims used to be held in August, and we needed to fill up the form during those times only. So at that point of time, one of the most important hurdle that I faced was to select the optional paper, because up till March I had the notion that I won't appear for for the exam, and suddenly there is a change in the policy and I am to appear within 5 months. So I searched a lot the entire night, and then I decided no, that optional can also be prepared. I searched a lot which optional can be prepared in the least amount of time, and after a lot of research I found out that it was anthropology. And so I took up anthropology and filled up the form and prepared rigorously for 5 months without thinking anything else for prelims. And by the grace of God, I was able to clear prelims in 2014. After prelims, I again fell in a quagmire. Nothing was prepared, neither essay nor GS, and an optional which I don't know what to study. So then firstly I took up my optional paper and I wrote 5 or 6 essays before the exam. And as far as GS is concerned, my preparation was very piecemeal because I could not even understand what exactly to study in my first attempt. But somehow, by the grace of God, I practiced answer writing through the test series, and I was able to clear the mains. And in 2014, I got rejected in the interview stage finally. So in 2015, when the attempt was to be given, it was just 1 month before prelims and CSAT had gone away. So we can't now bank upon CSAT to clear prelims. So I could not delve into much of what mistake I had did before, and I just went on to write the prelims exam. Fortunately, I again cleared the prelims, again sat for mains, cleared mains, gave the interview, the merit list was again out, and now again I got rejected in the first merit list. When I got rejected in the first merit list, it's the second time I got continuous rejection in the interview stage. So at that point of time, I thought, I gave a lot of thought, and finally I decided to know, now I have to think about a B plan. So I started to prepare for the examination like RBI Grade B, Assam Civil Service exam, and various other exams like NABARD, even SBIPO. Meanwhile, fortunately, there is a list, another list given out by UPSC, which is the reserve list. The reserve list came out and I found my name in the reserve list. And so it assured me a job in Indian Postal Service. And again, I left all the other strategies that I made regarding the other exams and started concentrating totally on UPSC. Then again, in the same process, I gave my third attempt. And in that attempt, again, I went to the interview stage and got an All India rank of 431, which secured me a position in Indian Revenue Service, Customs and Central Excise. And finally, this was my fourth attempt, and this time I secured a rank of 64, and in all likelihood I will be getting Indian Administrative Service. So from my experience of this almost half a decade with UPSC, by the grace of God, I could improve every year. In my first attempt I reached in the interview, in my second attempt it was reserve list. In my third attempt, I got an All India rank of 431, and in my fourth attempt, I got the All India rank of 64. So, in this session, I would like to touch into the nuances of how I prepared for each successive steps for the exam, and how I was able to improve every successive years. So, first of all, I would like to start saying that UPSC is a black box. We can't base our preparation on the question paper of the previous years. We can't base our preparation on what is generally told by some experts or some toppers. We can't base our preparation based on what we think ourselves, because our self-assessment too can be wrong. So first of all, the main thing is to understand and objectify what this exam demands. So first of all, it is the prelim stage. In prelims, there are three parts, I feel. First is the static portion. By static portion, I mean the conventional books like Lakshmikant, Spectrum, or Shankar IAS. So this kind of books are read by everyone. But the key is to revise them again and again and to get the concepts in the fingertips. Because if we do not make our static concepts clear, there would always be a structural deficit in the preparation. We might think that current affairs is more important, but we can't also deny the fact that current affairs of today may not be the current affairs of tomorrow, or will not be definitely. So, since UPSC, many people get through this exam in the first attempt itself, but there can be situations like in my case, where the journey can be a very long stretched one. So for that, it is very much mandatory to get the concepts of the static part very clear. And now, the second part, which is very important for prelims, is the current affairs. As far as the current affairs part is concerned, there are two ways in which one can prepare. First is the newspaper way, that is the conventional way to prepare current affairs from the newspaper. And secondly, the compilations that come out in the market. So as far as the newspaper is concerned, newspapers are very good for preparing ourselves for mains, as it helps us develop our perspective and opinions. But for prelims, what I felt is that it is like searching needle in the haystack. You imagine the questions will be the amount of corpus in National Infrastructure Investment Fund. So it was given 4 lakh in the question, and the fact is 40,000, 4 lakh crore in the question, and the fact is that it contains a corpus of 40,000 crore. So such kind of minute facts are very difficult to be mined from the newspaper. So I suggest reading compilation for preparing current affairs for the prelim part. First of all, because compilations are very exhaustive. One need not think that whether one has missed something or not. Secondly, it is very easy to revise before the exam, and revision is one of the most important keys to clear this exam. Thirdly, anyone and everyone can start reading those compilations, because in those compilations even the backward linkages are given. So it becomes a lot easy for anyone to understand the background as well, which is difficult at times to read from the newspaper. And fourthly, the most important thing is that the facts get cleared. That is the most important thing, because in newspaper it is practically very difficult to find out the fact and mine them and then jot down and keep the notes. It wastes a lot of time. So I suggest going for a compilation for the current affairs parts for prelims. Remember, for prelims, I have not said it about mains. Next, the third part for prelims is what I say, the statodynamic part. By statodynamic part, I mean those questions which are neither present in the conventional books nor they are a part of the current affairs. For example, there was a question asked in 2016 prelims that which of the following heads have the highest weightage in the infrastructure index, Indian infrastructure index. So the options were manufacturing, electricity and mining. So such kind of questions one would not find in the newspaper, and at the same time it is very difficult to find those questions in the conventional books as well. So for those questions, it is generally prescribable to go through the compilation of the Indian yearbook. So Indian yearbook in that way would help one to develop those peripheral knowledge which is very difficult to get in the newspaper as well as the textbooks. But no need to study that bulky India yearbook. There are good compilations in the market. Go for those compilations. They filter everything that is important for UPSC and give a very good compilation of the entire India yearbook. Then in the statodynamic part, I would like to emphasize on certain lists which need to be prepared. For example, the list of national park and the state in which they are. The list of biodiversity reserves of India, the list of the Ramsar sites, then the list of the international organizations in which India are a part, and to know the members of those organizations. Because such kind of questions are very common in UPSC. For example, there was a question that which river flows through the Jim Corbett National Park. So if one knows where Jim Corbett National Park is, it is in Uttarakhand, and one knows where the rivers given in the options are, then one can make a very calculated guess that Ram Ganga flows through Jim Corbett National Park, because Ram Ganga is the only option present in the question which flows through that region. So in that way, it makes one capable to make calculated guesses in the paper. Now I want to touch a very important aspect of how to practice question papers for prelims. So there are three benefits of practicing question papers. First of all, through question papers, by tallying the marks of the improvement, one can see how progressive one's preparation is. Suppose one is scoring 60 in the first test and 65 in the second test. So basically there is an improvement of 5 marks, but one need not worry, because one would go for attempting 30 or 35 questions before prelims. So first of all, it helps us to keep a track on how far we are improving. Secondly, tests to a great extent help us improving our knowledge, because there are many things which are difficult to mine from the conventional books and newspaper, and they fall into focus in the model answer sheets of the test papers. So definitely attempting for more tests enhances one's knowledge. The third most important thing that test helps us to do is to guess or to frame or to make our mind how many questions to attempt in prelims. Generally, it is a thing which is always a great controversy, that how many questions are to be attempted for prelims. So as far as this thing is concerned, I believe that it can't be universalized. It depends upon one particular person how many questions to attempt. So what was my strategy to attempt was that there are 100 questions in the question paper. So I used to categorize these 100 questions into 4 parts. 1, 2, 3 and 4. The category 1 comprises of those questions in which I am 100% sure that I know the answer and I have eliminated all the 3 other options. In the second category, there are questions in which I was successful in eliminating 2 options. In the third category are the questions in which I succeeded in eliminating only 1 option. And in the fourth category are the questions which I don't know at all, and I am pretty sure that I won't be able to touch them. So after categorizing these 100 questions into 4 categories, the next thing that I used to do is to totally discard this 4 and answer this all the questions under this category 1. So then the next step of the strategy is to count how many answers fell in the category 1. So if it is more than 50 or 55, then it is a good news that more guesses aren't to be made. So in that case, I go for attempting this category 2 questions to the extent that I in totality attempt around 80 questions. In my first attempt, I attempted 79. In my second attempt, I attempted 81. In my third attempt, I again attempted 78. And in my fourth attempt, I attempted 84. And consistently, I have been scoring 20 marks more than the cutoff. So this practice helped me to find out whether I am good at guessing or I have good amount of accuracy. So since I had good amount of accuracy, I need not guess more. And so I got maximum number of attempted questions correct. So now if somebody finds that one is able to get only 35 to 40 questions in this category, then there is no other option but to attempt even the questions in which one is able to eliminate only one option. So in that way, one can guess the amount of questions to be attempted. So this exercise is very difficult to be implemented directly in the exam. So practicing the question papers would help one to devise a strategy in order to find out how many number of questions need to be attempted to clear this exam or to clear the cutoff. So this is all I had to say about prelims. Now coming to the mains part. So I believe that mains is that part of the exam which sets UPSC apart from all the other exams, because here first of all we need to attempt 9 subjective papers, of which 7 are calculated in the merit list, and that too the span between each exam is very less. It is a continuous stretch of 5-6 days where one has to write every day for 6 hours. Thirdly, there is a limited time span to write those answers. We have to attempt 20 questions in this span of 3 hours. So there needs to be a lot of practice and training in order to reach a stage where we can make our mains go well. So my journey in UPSC has been such that I was able to improve every year in mains. In my first attempt, I cleared the cutoff by 12 marks. In my second attempt, I was able to clear the cutoff by 26 marks. In my third attempt, I was able to clear the mains cutoff by around 43 marks. And in my fourth attempt, finally, I was able to clear the cutoff by 81 marks. So I have been improving every year in mains. So what exactly was my strategy? First of all, in the first attempt, I never understood what exactly to write. So my answers also were not structured and they lacked in content as well. But since I was able to score pretty good in essays, so I got an interview call. My GS marks were really poor in my first attempt. In my second attempt, I just took up the question paper of the first attempt mains and then started to think what exactly I wrote in those answers. So when I thought about what I wrote, then I was able to think of what more could have been done. So this could have been done in this question, this could have been done in this question. So in that way, I was able to enhance the value in the second attempt too. So it was a baby step of increasing 20 to 25 marks in the second attempt from the first attempt. In my third attempt, what I did and what I realized was that my answers are now fine, but it lacks structure. Especially in the question in which I needed to give opinions and the question in which I did not know. So for the aspirants, I would like to say one more thing. That in UPSC mains, there would be 13 to 14 questions out of 20 which would be known very well. 3 to 4 questions would be a little grey, in which we have certain information but it is not up to that extent as in the first 13 or 14 questions. And there would be 3 to 4 questions where we can't even think what to write. So for that also, I devised a proper structure and a strategy. And the strategy was such that for any question, if we tried to implement that strategy, it would work. So for every question, there is an introduction. Then there is this body. Then there is this added information. And finally, it is the conclusion. So now I had divided this A, every question into these four parts: introduction, body, added information, and then conclusion. So even if we don't know what to write in a particular answer, we will be able to write it if we make our answer structured in this blueprint. So in introduction, what I used to do is to write about a current event which has taken place regarding this particular issue. Now say, for example, let us take up a question. There was a question in 2016 mains that can the contemporary caste movements lead to annihilation of caste system in India. So the question was of 12.5 marks, and the question was, can it lead to? So if we analyze this question using this structure, how would the structure be? First of all, introduction. In introduction, the first thing, the first current thing that came to my mind at that point of time was that there was a Mahayatra organized by the Dalit Front in Gujarat post the Una incident of lynching the two cow skinners by the self-proclaimed Gau Rakshaks. So I gave this current dimension as my introduction, because that was read in the newspaper, and so I was able to think about it and wrote it. Then body basically can be compartmentalized into two types. One type can be cause-effect analysis, and the other can be pro-cons analysis. So in this question, the question was, can contemporary caste movements lead to annihilation of caste system in India? So this is a question where we have to find out whether one thing leads to another. So here we have to do this cause-effect analysis. So what are the causes of the contemporary caste movements? So we have multifarious causes behind this. There are increasing amount of marginalization of the various communities which have been historically marginalized. There have been political awakening among those communities. There has been rise of fringe elements like Gau Rakshas, etc. So those are all the causes of the contemporary caste movements. Now what are the effects of this contemporary caste movements? So the effects can be said that this kind of caste movements are leading to more sensitization of the people about the issues faced by various communities. Second thing is that it is leading to politicization of those people who were hitherto not politicized. The third thing can be that there is an increasing class in the castes. Okay, because the movements we have seen in various instances are done by people who are already well off, and they are also getting the advantages of the reservation system. So these are the effects. And finally, there can be one more effect which can be said, that there is increasing hatred between the people. So now, after we have done the cost effect analysis, since the question was that can it lead to annihilation of caste system, we would have to see that the effect analysis that we had made, whether it would somehow lead to annihilation of caste system or not. Okay, so after that, once we have thought that whether it can do it or not, we can go for the added information part, that what has government done or the constitution demands to be done in order to create an egalitarian society. For example, we have various articles in the constitution, various articles in DPSP and FR, which says that discrimination on caste grounds are not allowed by law, by the constitution. So such kind of added information can be given. One more, another added information that can be given is that one of the greatest propounder of annihilation of caste system in India was the maker or the father of our constitution, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So this kind of added information adds to the content part of the question, and when the examiner reads those answers, the examiner becomes pretty sure that this particular student has a lot of clarity and knowledge about that particular subject. Then finally, in such questions, since it was asked about can, so we have to give an answer whether it can or not. So we have to take a stand. But since it is UPSC Civil Service mains exam, so one does not just expect a student to write just whether it can lead or not. So we can add some added line saying that if these particular steps are taken, then it would lead to beneficial of those vulnerable sections. It can lead to furtherance of this part of the constitution. So giving a positive note, which is very much essential for the exam, because I would say that the examiner gives the mark just after reading the conclusion. So my advice to the aspirants is that write the conclusion in a positive note, so that the examiner gets a feel that this person thinks that there are avenues to work on, rather than having an inhibited point of view that we can't do anything. So that is from the point of view of how to write an answer. So this kind of things come with constant practice, because it is not that I was able to devise this strategy in one single night. I have been practicing over and over again, and then I found out that any question, whether I know or don't know, can fit into this blueprint, and I can write a coherent answer in any question that is asked in mains exam. Now the third thing which is very important for mains is answer writing. This is the most important thing for the mains exam. So now, how to write the answers, or what are the models available and which are employed by various candidates to write the answers. The first model of writing answers is to write isolated questions that one gets from the websites daily. For example, we take up 2 or 3 questions from Insights on India and write it daily. So this method has its own pro and cons also. The pro of this method is that it keeps a student in touch of answer writing throughout the year. So one will write 2 or 3 questions every day, so there will be no inhibition while appearing for the real mains exam. But the problem with this strategy is that we seldom keep on track the time we take to write each answer. So if we think in that way, we might even take 40-45 minutes to write 2 answers. But we won't have this kind of environment during the exam, because in exam we have to write 20 questions in 3 hours, which means 7.5 to 8 minutes for every answer. So for that, to prepare oneself for that kind of environment, one can go for a full-fledged test series, which provides a complete 3-hour ambience to write the 20 questions, and then one can find out how many questions one could attempt in the first test, and accordingly one needs to enhance one's speed to attempt maximum number of questions as possible. The third strategy is for the people who are already in job and are preparing for the mains exam and who do not have much time to prepare. The third way to prepare answer writing, I would say, is to take up the model answer sheets, read the questions and frame the answers in mind. But to follow this strategy, one has to be pretty sure that one has a good writing speed and he or she can complete the mains paper. So once one is sure that he can complete the mains paper, he or she can go for this strategy, that to see the questions and to think about the answer to that particular question. So if we can frame the answer in mind and have an adequate amount of speed, we can definitely write the answer in the exam. So the pro of this strategy is that we can cover maximum number of questions. For example, in my 4th attempt this year, I did not write a single answer. I took up the model answers of 5 institutes and just kept on reading those questions and framed the answers in my mind, and through that I was able to cover more than 500 questions. So this is a very helpful strategy, but it should not be applied by people who are writing mains for the first time or even second time, because one cannot be sure whether one is good in speed writing or not. So now, having said about the GS paper, I want to touch a little about the essay paper. So essay is a very important paper, because if you see the weightage of marks that one can score in essay is much more than the GS paper. One can score easily above 140 marks out of 250 in essay if the essay is of good content and most importantly having a good structure. So what are the steps that are needed to be followed in order to attempt an essay paper? First of all, the essay paper in UPSC generally consists of two sections, and one has to write one essay each from each of the two sections. So generally we can categorize those essays into two parts. One are the philosophical essays and the other are the general essays which we can link to the general studies syllabus. So the first greatest hurdle is to choose the essay which one needs to write. So there would be various things which one needs to keep in mind while selecting those essays. First of all, there can be a notion that we should select the essay which is very close to our optional paper. But I say that it can be very risky too. I myself have bear the brunt of committing this mistake. In my second attempt, I wrote an essay that the character of an institution is reflected in its leader. So since it was a question from it was an essay from the institution part, and institution is somehow linked to my optional, that is anthropology, so I thought that I can write a very good essay when it comes to those topics. So I took up that essay and wrote a very theoretical essay which is very much in line with the answer that I write in the optional. But at the end of the day, we should not forget the fact that the essay will be corrected by someone who is a generalist. He or she might not know the various thinkers or the various opinions that is there in an optional subject. So before selecting an essay which is close to one's optional, one should be very cautious that he or she should write in a very generalized way. We should not show our expertise in an essay paper. We should write very generally so that a generalist, anyone and everyone reading the essay, can understand it, and it takes lesser time and energy and effort for him to understand it. So this is the first thing I wanted to say about essay. The second thing that is most important in an essay is the structure of the essay. So we all know that there are three parts. First is the introduction, second is the body, and the third is the conclusion. So introduction, I believe, is a very important part, because once gets the first impression of what the essay is heading towards by our introduction. So introduction can be basically done in three ways. The first way is to give a lump sum idea of what the essay is about. Suppose the essay says the character of an institution is reflected in its leader. So there we can start off with what an institution is and what are the things, what are the attributes of a good leader. So this is a conventional way to start an essay. The second way to start an essay is by using a quote from a famous personality. For example, in this year's essay about New Woman, I started the essay with a quote of Swami Vivekananda, in which he had said once that like a bird can't fly with a single wing, it is not possible for a nation to develop when one of its half is disempowered. So this is a second way to start off an essay, that is through giving a quote by a famous personality. The third way to start an essay, which is very fascinating but at the same time which can be very risky, is a sensationalized start by giving a case study or a story in the context of that essay right at the very beginning. So if one is able to put in the context very well, one would be able to score really good, but it can go the other way around too. So until and unless a person is very much comfortable and pretty sure that one can write it and give proper justice to the essay, one should not go for starting with stories or the case studies. But if one is pretty sure, one should go. Then after introduction comes the body. In body, there are two things which are of utmost importance. First is the content. So in UPSC we say is an exam of the content or the knowledge. So content is the most important thing. If we don't have content, we can't do anything. Content is the only weapon. But in addition to content, one of the most important thing is structure. By structure I mean that there should be a coherence in what we are saying in the essay. It should not be that in one paragraph we say one thing and in the other paragraph we say another thing. So for that, there should always be connections between each preceding and succeeding paragraphs. So how to give the connections? So the connections can be given by connectors like likewise, in the same note, in the same way. So such kind of connectors are very helpful to make our essay go very coherent. And even the examiner who will read the essay will have a very good feeling due to the lucidity that the essay provides. And he or she will be very much interested to read our essay. And that itself would help us score more. So, after the body comes the conclusion. So now what to write in a conclusion? Like I have said in the GS answers too, marks will be given just after writing the conclusion. So conclusion should be positive, that is the first thing. And secondly, conclusion, one should not mistake conclusion as something we write, hence it is proved that we can do this. No. In an essay, the conclusion can be of various modes. So one of the mode that I would like to emphasize over here is that for a particular issue, one can write what the legislature can do about it, what the executive can do about it, what the judiciary can do about it, what the civil society of media and NGO can do about it, what we as citizens can do about it, and finally, if we do or if those particular steps are fulfilled, what are the values of the constitution that will be furthered? What are the sustainable development goals that will be furthered? What are the vulnerable sections of the marginalized people who will be affected or impacted in a positive way by these baby steps? So this kind of things, this kind of ending give a very positive note and a good feeling to the examiner, and one will be, I am pretty sure, able to get very good marks. So now, since I have said about the various things like the values of the constitution or the SDGs, so there are some small tricks which I would like to share with you all. Remember the DPSPs very well. Remember the fundamental rights very well. Remember the syllabus of UPSC very well. I would suggest mug up the syllabus, because when one cannot think in any way, just think of the syllabus of UPSC. One will be able to get any answer. One will be able to write a very coherent, good essay just by merely thinking on the lines of the syllabus of UPSC. For example, any essay, say woman, we can start off by thinking GS paper 1. GS paper 1, the first part is history. How has historically been the condition of woman? Secondly, in the world, how has been the condition, and in India, how has been the condition in ancient, medieval and modern times? So this is the first dimension. The second dimension, society. Now you think about the society syllabus. In society we have population, poverty, globalization, urbanization, etc. So we can think about all those dimensions, how poverty and women are linked, how population and women empowerment is linked, how globalization and women empowerment is linked. The next part is geography. How hill areas women differ in terms of their daily course to the women in plain areas. So this is the dimension from geography. Then comes paper 2, which is polity. In polity, we can think about what are the constitutional provisions for women empowerment that is given and what have been the progress so far. Next part comes governance. In governance, we have various issues like SHGs, NGOs, how NGOs can work for women empowerment, how are SHGs empowering women. The next part is international relations. How women are incorporated, the view of the women are incorporated in diplomacy. Then come economy. In GS paper 3, if we think of economy and agriculture, we have various dimensions through which we can link women empowerment to economy and agriculture. Next, disaster management, ecology, even internal security we can link with women empowerment. Then finally, ethics. We have many things we can write from the ethical point of view as far as women empowerment is concerned. So now through this, I have given you an example where anyone can write a good, proper, coherent essay having proper content and structure just by merely thinking about the syllabus of UPSC, GS. So this is one thing. Then we can think about the SDGs. Which of the SDGs can be furthered? Because once we quote the number of the SDG or the aim of the SDG, it becomes very apparent that this person knows this topic very well. So I hope my essay strategy would help you. Next, coming to the most important part of the mains exam, that is the optional paper. So if we see the weightage of the optional paper, the rankers have been scoring more than 60%, that is more than 300. Many rankers have scored more than 300 out of 500 in the optional paper, and some have even crossed 350, that is the 70% marks. So one can imagine how important is optional to clear the mains or to get a name in the merit list. So the first thing in an optional paper is to understand what the subject really demands. There is a particular perspective of every subject. Anthropology, sociology, geography, every subject has its own particular perspective. So in the answers of the optional paper, we have to answer those questions in the perspective of that very subject. The same questions which are asked in the optional paper can be asked in GS, can be asked in another optional paper as well. For example, that this question about caste system which was asked in GS can be asked in sociology, and the same question can be asked in anthropology as well. But the analysis that I have given to you is applicable only while writing a GS answer. Because in optional, if I write such generalized analysis of pro, cons and cause and effect, the examiner would definitely cut my marks. Here we have to start the question giving the name of a thinker who has given a lot of opinions about caste system in India. Then the alternative opinions given about the caste system. Then what are the contemporary trends? Then we have to add the case studies, a contemporary case study about that particular issue. So the answer itself becomes totally different. But if I write the same answer in GS paper, the generalist won't be, have to put a lot of effort to read and understand my answer. So they would cut my marks. So what point I wanted to emphasize is that in optional, there is a particular perspective and we have to follow that particular perspective to write the answer, and in GS we have to write in a very generalized, coherent way. That is the first thing. Secondly, optional paper is an investment made for the entire journey of UPSC, because the syllabus of the optional paper hardly changes, and so I have been constantly able to improve in my optional paper. Mainly in my first attempt, I scored 225 in anthropology. In my second attempt, I scored 248 in anthropology. In my third attempt, I scored 287 in anthropology. And in this attempt, I scored 320. So, how I improved in the subsequent attempts? So, first of all, in the first attempt, I had a very general idea about the subject. I just marked up the various institutions' notes and went to write the exam. There was no value addition. I just wrote the answers very mechanically. So, I was able to score just 225. In the second attempt, when I analyzed that what went wrong in my optional paper, people were scoring 250, 270 plus in optional. Why did I score only 225? I found that I was lacking even in some basic part. So, in my second attempt, I wrote the basic books. For example, Indian Anthropology for Nadeem Hasnain and Tribal India for Nadeem Hasnain. Then I took up even Ember and Ember. So, reading those books, I realized that there are very basic fundamental things that were missing in my preparation. And so, in my second attempt while writing those answers, I was able to incorporate those fundamental basic parts which were missing in my second attempt. In my third attempt, again I thought that no, I was not getting mark in the highest notch. What more can be improved? So in my second attempt, I read one of the topper talks in which she mentioned about the importance of case study in writing optional answers. So in my third attempt, what I did, I took up every line of the syllabus mentioned by the UPSC in anthropology, and I took up and searched in the internet a particular contemporary case study about every topic mentioned in the syllabus. So what I did in my third attempt, that none of the answers attempted were devoid of case studies and examples. So just by incorporating case studies and example, I was able to improve 40 marks in optional in my second to third attempt. Now once I had reached 287, so I got a feel that how much more can I improve. So at max I thought that I would be improving 10 to 15 marks. So how was it possible? So the next thing that I did was that for everything that I have done in the previous attempts that remained stagnant, apart from that, I just added diagrams. So in this attempt, I added diagrams to my answers in anthropology. In my physical anthropology part, I drew the skulls. In the questions of cultural social anthropology, like language diversity in India, cultural diversity in India, I drew the map of India and showed a visual dimension of how are the conditions of tribes or how are the conditions of various languages in India in different parts of the country. So in that way it helped me. That was the first dimension, by incorporating diagrams and maps. The second thing which I incorporated in my fourth attempt in optional paper is that I took elements or data from GS, because anthropology is a very general subject. So many a times we find various articles in the newspaper, various things in when we study the social issues part or NGOs, public administration part, which can be incorporated in the optional answers. So what I did, I made a list of the schemes of Government of India or any state which can be incorporated in my optional answers. I took out the data present in my GS books in order to incorporate those data in context with anthropology. So this baby step of just giving diagrams and data and schemes from GS to anthropology helped me improve 33 marks from last year, 287 to 320 this year. So I would say that these small baby steps would one day assure that one definitely reaches the goal or the dream one aspires. It is not a big deal if one fails in one test. The most important thing is to go back home and analyze in what way have we gone wrong in the previous attempt. So in this context, one of the exercises that I did post mains every year was that, even I did it this year because I was already prepared for the preliminary exam. I thought that I'll have to give one more attempt, but by the grace of Almighty, I am out of the loop and I need not attempt for UPSC again. So every year after mains, I used to take a break of 2-3 days. After 2-3 days, I used to take up the question papers and then read each and every question very minutely, thinking about what I have written. Then I used to think of what more could have been done, and I used to jot down those points that these are the things which could have been done to improve this answer. So once I had a diary, and I used to jot down the points that these are the things which I need to incorporate in my next attempt. So first attempt I did, after first attempt I did this, some points came out. After second attempt I did this, some other points came out. After third attempt I did this, some other points came out. And believe me, even when I did after this attempt, some more points came out. And for that, I just worked on the points which came out, keep taking into account and concerning the fact that whatever I have gained so far does not get lost. So I just concentrated on the points that came out and worked on that in every subsequent attempt, and I was able to improve in mains from one succeeding year to another for the last 4 years. So I would say that after mains, or even after prelims, one can analyze one's paper. Don't take much time, because after 10-15 days from mains, after the mains exam is over, one tend to forget what one has written in the exam. So just after 2-3 days the mains exam ends, take up the question paper, analyze what went wrong and what more can be done, jot down in a diary or a notebook and keep it aside. And before mains the next year, when one prepare for the mains for the next year, one should just work in those points which came up, and obviously make sure that whatever thing has been gained in the previous attempt also remains. So I think this much all I have to say about the mains part. Thirdly, the interview part. So my interview marks have been fluctuating all throughout. In my first attempt I got 151. In my second and third attempt I got 179 each. And this time it has deteriorated again to 171. So I believe that interview is a stage where there is a tinge of luck factor too, because it depends upon various dimensions that which panel one gets and which are the questions that can be asked to him or her, or how far we have prepared our DAF well. So there are various opinions regarding preparation for interview, that one can change one's personality. What I believe is that personality is something which is developed in the process of one's socialization. So coming at this age, one cannot change one's basic personality, and secondly, it is not prescribable to change it. So what can be changed or developed are the ways of interaction, or the various soft skills like how we dress, how we address one, how we can say thank you or sorry. So these are the soft skills which can be enhanced, but not the personality. So irrespective of the things like how one pronounces, how one speaks, the most important thing that has to be taken into mind is we can enhance our soft skills but not change our personality. So never ever go for changing one's own personality. Second thing from the preparational part, I believe that there are two things which are the most important for interview. First is the detailed application form that one fills up after prelims. So most of the questions that are asked are from the detailed application form, and apart from this, it is the current affairs. So any questions asked from general studies or current affairs or some random topics, if one is not able to answer, I don't think that it would create any problem. But if one is not able to answer questions from one's own DAF, then it can create a lot of problems. And interview stage, I believe, is the stage which can decide one's rank. Mains is very important to get into the merit list, but interview is the most important stage, I believe, to decide one's rank, because we find that many people have done very well in the mains exam, but they scored very less in the interview. and they were not able to get the desired rank which they wanted. So for the interview stage, prepare the DAV very rigorously so that none of the questions remain unanswered from that part. Prepare current affairs and just work on the soft skills. No need to go for changing one's own personality overnight, because it is not possible to do it. Finally, we have come to the concluding part of this session. So finally, I would like to say about the mental or the spiritual dimension of preparation of UPSC. So there are various opinions about the strategies, but there is only one single universalized opinion about the mental or the spiritual context, is that UPSC is a mind game. There are various cases you will find, starting from the ones who just prepare for 5 months and clear this exam. Then there are cases who get it in their second attempt, and people like us who get the ultimate thing which we want in the fourth attempt. So it can be a journey as small as 5-6 months or a year, or it can stretch up to even 6-7 years for some people. So the most important thing is to have a very calm and composed mind. Be happy in this preparational stage, because irrespective of the result, there is one thing that which every one of us is gaining through this preparational phase itself, is the sensitization and awareness. And the sensitization and awareness that we are gaining can be applied to any of the walks of life, and we can make this world a better place to live in to the best of our capacity by this knowledge and awareness that we are getting in this stage of preparation itself. Second thing is the ability to shift the gear. There would be times when you would get rejected in the interview stage, and prelims exam would just be 10 days down the line. So at that period of time, one would not even get the time to think about the sadness or be gloomy. We have to shift the gear immediately after the result, accepting the fact that no, it did not go well this year, but it will go well the next year. We should always see the ray of light coming out of the dark tunnel, and we should believe that surrounding every dark cloud there is a silver lining. So this is the second thing. And the third most important thing that I would like to emphasize is that there is no connotation of superiority and inferiority in this exam, because I believe that all the people who are preparing for this exam are very talented. Some people who have been more talented in all aspects than me for this exam too, they have good writing skills, they have good communication skills, they have good analysis, they have good repository of knowledge, but still due to some factor or the other they are not able to clear. But I would like to emphasize on the fact that every one of them who have prepared well, sincerely for this exam, would do well in the final examination, that is the life. And one more thing, those who have got rejected this year, for them I would say that maybe you could have got the 500 or 600 rank this year. So aim something that you can get top 10 or even the first rank next year, so that you need not worry again. Because the cycle may not end even if one gets a rank, but it would end finally if one gets what one desires. And desire is a very generalized term. What we desire today, we may not desire tomorrow. So just focus on the exam, have a clear strategy, have a good sleep, have a good interaction with friends and family, and be happy. That is the most important thing, and you will definitely be able to reach your goal, if not in this exam, definitely in life. With that, I conclude this session. Thank you. Thank you.